On today's podcast?
That's who I am. That's the knowledge I have spent my whole life incurring. That's the wisdom that I have drawn as a mother and a woman and a wife. I am that. And my work in this class and the medicine that I take, they allow those two to sync together.
ADHD Rewired, episode 160. This is the show designed for those of us with really good intentions, but a slightly wandering attention. My name is Eric Tivers. I'm a licensed clinical social worker, coach, and speaker. The website is ADHDRewired.com. We know that starting is the hardest part, so let's get started. Welcome back to another episode of ADHD Rewired. Today's guest is Nicole. Nicole is 42. She's from Minnesota. Her background is in sales and business. She's a mom of two, a wife, and she has been a member of our most recent ADHD Rewired Coaching and Accountability Group. And I invited Nicole to the show today to share her story with you. Nicole, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
So let's start with this. What's your story?
I grew up in a small rural community, and so I'm 42, whatever. I don't know if you do the math, how many years back, how should we know about ADD at the time when I was in elementary school, but I don't think that whatever we did know had reached this rural elementary school. And I wasn't actually diagnosed until I was a senior in college. So I sometimes have a hard time remembering where I was in elementary school. I remember doing something regularly where I would just get so bored. And so I just couldn't stand being there. And I would basically say, can I go to the nurse's office? And I remember laying in the nurse's office, and there's like this brick wall by the cot. And I actually remember tracing, the bricks and counting them and the colors. And I just couldn't be in class anymore. And it was also an opportunity for me to get some attention from my parents. They are entrepreneurs. They worked very hard, very long hours. And I didn't get, some of the attention I think I needed. So I wasn't sure what was happening, but I knew that I couldn't stand sitting in the class all the time. So fast forward to college, I completed my studies with no diagnosis, no medication. I graduated in just over 4 years. And I was a senior, and I wasn't sure what I wanted to do for a job. So I pursued a therapy session with this particular, I just lucked into happen to meet a guy who knew a lot about ADD as well as in adults. And I was telling him that I had some trepidation around what I was going to do and whatnot. And he said, can I ask you a question? And I said, yeah. And he goes, do you have any idea how many, there was like a big glass window behind him and a staircase. You could see out the window. He said, how many people have gone up and down that staircase since we've been in this session together? And I said, 4. And then he asked me another question. He goes, I think you have ADD, because people with ADD can pay attention to like the conversation and like what's going on around them and so on and so forth. It wasn't his only primary diagnosis.
That's the first time I've ever heard that as a
as a diagnostic. Yeah. So no, but he did in fact then do a myriad of other tests and determined that I was part of the club.
That you're part of the club. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so that you were in your early 20s then?
Yes, I was in my early 20s. And sorry, my earphones are bugging me. Okay, we're just going to make a little stop there, right?
I've marked okay. The audio.
So I think, fast forward to kind of the part where I finally decided to try medication. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, many years went by where I think the type I tried and stuff, it's somewhat irrelevant, because what I learned from Ari Tuchman is that, you know, it really is this triad. It's the medicine, it's the skills, and it's the support.
Was that stuff. Who you saw? Was Ari?
No, I just started reading and pursuing books and
okay,
podcasts and speakers and stuff. And Ari
and for listeners, if you don't know who Ari Tuchman is, he's a psychologist. Does a lot of work in the field of adult ADHDs. He's out in Pennsylvania. He used to do a podcast. I think it's a coincidence, but he appeared to stop doing the podcast around the time I started doing a podcast. But they're really short. He has over 100 episodes, about 10 or so minutes each. Really good, digestible sort of snack size audio files, if you want to call them that. So that's Ari Tuchman.
However, funny you should say that, because although I learned a great deal through his podcasts as well as his book, I was suspect that he doesn't have ADD. And there is a certain something that I needed in a coach and in an education source, which is what I found when I started listening to your podcasts. Mm-hmm. But before I got there, I was in, so through your class, I also was introduced to YouTube, the speaker, Dr. Russell Barclay.
Mm-hmm. Barclay.
And it was there that I started to really understand more of the science behind, what it is that drives me and how my brain works. And so it was through that I understood that I have a neurodevelopmental disorder. And it's been in accepting that truth that I have found enormous freedom. And it's so ironic, because the story actually comes full circle. I had listened to him about 2.5 years ago. I finally was at that vulnerable place where I knew I needed some help. I wanted to look beyond medication, and I sought out a coach. And I sort of did, this creative search. I found some coaches with ADD who were, self-certified coaches, mm-hmm. and some of them were not helpful. Mm-hmm. And then I found one in particular. She did not have ADD, but her whole family did. Mm-hmm. And it was one of the most horrible experiences of my adult life as a person who was diagnosed with ADD, because here I was finally taking some steps, this evolution of who I was. And she made me feel scared that I was going to be like a number or a statistic of the many people that never, I think the expression she used was like, many people with ADD are like rockets, and they all just sit on the runway with no, they have all this fuel and all this possibility in them, but it never gets ignited, and they never even take off, and they just sit on the ground.
And ready to get started now?
Right? Oh, where can I, here's my visa, So like, and then she also said, you have to watch this doctor link. So she sends this link of Dr. Barclay, and it's like it's a snippet of like one of the most depressing talks I think he gives, because it's sort of then scientific proof of what she said.
Right.
Okay. So I went into a shell at that time. And I think I started just getting progressively more afraid. And I started playing a smaller game in life month by month, to the point where I started, because now at this point I have completely my ADD. I don't understand I don't understand enough about it to understand that it's not totally who I am. So I think I have no control and I have potential, but who even cares? Cause I'm never going to amount to anything. And I just start becoming almost so challenged to do like just basic household things.
You know what? I'm having like three tangential thoughts.
Okay.
So the rocket on the runaway, first of all, the rocket's in the wrong place, because it needs to be on a launch pad. So clearly the rocket has ADHD.
Thank you for that transportation clarification. I clearly do not have little boys. I have little girls. Okay.
My second tangent of thought is when you mentioned first Dr. Barkley, you said he's a speaker doctor, and my thought was like, mm-hmm. we should call him a spockter. Spockter is kind of a cool word, you know, especially if you like Star Trek. I always confuse the two. So for any Trekkies, you're like, no, you ruined what,
Spockter. If you were a spectator of such, you would be a spectator of spectators.
And if you were a speaking spectator, you'd be a speaker spectator. Okay. We need to cut this off. Sometimes one of the best things we can do is cut our losses and say,
let's
get back to where we were. Okay.
So needless to say, though, the only thing that I came out of that conversation with, because I did pay for a few sessions with this lady, and I just came away thinking, you know, I bet your family hates you because you are so condescending and you are so, you have put us in this really, and she would just say, everybody's got ADD in my house except me. And, you know, when you get up in the morning, you got to have your medicines right by your nightstand. And I'm just like, okay, there's got to be more than this. So off I go on a search to try to find something. And that's when I find your podcast. And I start listening and I just start soaking it in. And I start hearing real people with, a variety of lifestyle things going on. There's just so much richness there. And I'm going to just put this podcast in my own terms, this Dr. Barclay's podcast, where he talks about the difference between your brain and the, you know, working memory piece, and how the two are not necessarily talking anyway, I'm not going to try and explain that. Little cut there. I might want to edit that. Okay.
That's the best part, though, when you're trying to explain something.
This is how I do for my kids. Okay, I'm going to show you this little post-it note. Okay.
Okay, so for the
brain.
Yeah,
so this is my brain, the big
for the symbol. Listeners, she's a 2x2 post-it note. It's blue. Mm-hmm. It has a egg-shaped circle. On the top says large. On the bottom says, say, intellect.
Uh-huh.
With a pointing just to, say, 9 o'clock, to a small egg. It's like a little baby egg. Probably about the same proportion as the sun to the earth. And underneath that, it says working memory. And there's a dashed line with arrows on top and bottom. So at 12 and 6, it's dashed. So on the left, it's the large intellect egg. And then the dashed line. And then on the right is the small working memory. How was that?
Beautiful. So this is what I got from his podcast. He says in our culture, basically, that we have tried to turn ADD into this creative genius in my own words, we're trying to meld it all into this one thing. Instead of saying, which is more how I'm interpreting it, I am a creative person with ADD. I'm an avid reader and a knowledge seeker with ADD. Okay. I'm a businesswoman with ADD. And why is that important? Because when I meld it all into my personality, some really negative things start to happen. One, I lose my identity. And then I don't know where I begin and ADD begins where I end. So there is a fear also in treating that ADD, because if I identify that as being the source of my creative genius, the source of my intellect, the source of my capabilities, then it's almost like then I have the little war that starts in my brain over, well, am I really suppressing my creative genius? Is this what kind of culture are we in that we have to medicate, like, you know, one flew over the cuckoo's nest. I mean, why don't I just get shock treatments? I mean, that's the sort of drama that I was putting into medicating that. And instead I see it now. When I heard that, that was probably like week 3 or 4 in our class. That was one of the most freeing podcasts that I had finally had the courage to listen to, because my self-confidence was so much stronger because of the group we were in. I was able to go back and listen to that resource, that being Dr. Russell, and not be afraid to take on the idea that it's okay. I have a neurodevelopmental disorder. There is an acceptance that comes with that. And now I can look at that post-it note I showed you, that large circle, which represents my brain and my intellect. Mm-hmm. That's who I am. That's the knowledge I have spent my whole life incurring. That's the wisdom that I have drawn as a mother and a woman and a wife. I am that. And that small egg is the working memory. And my work in this class and the medicine that I take, they allow those two to sync together so I can tap into that. Right?
It's like putting the key in the ignition that helps you get from where you are to where you want to go.
Yes. And all of a sudden, so then after like 2 days for our class, you know, it was like right around our goal setting time, I got to sit down and create, okay, what's possible for me if I accept the fact that I have intellect? Like, what kind of jobs can I, because I had limited myself, the jobs and the responsibilities and the duties kept getting smaller and smaller and smaller. At one point I went through it doesn't matter. I would go through situations where I would look at people maybe even not even making minimum wage and say, oh my gosh, like I don't think I could do that job. There's too much memory involved or whatever in that thing. I had really limited myself. Okay.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. Two things. First, and we didn't really talk about this ahead of time, but I think it's contextual. So we are now in week 9 of the coaching group. So we have this and next week left. Yesterday, we did an exercise where it was a writing exercise that we did during group where I asked you to write a letter, and I gave you two words to start the letter. And the two words were, Dear ADHD. Mm-hmm. Would you be willing to share that?
You know what? Yes, I would. And I am so organized now, Mr. Tivers, that I might even be able to find it, although I was not prepared prior to our conversation. If you give me one moment.
Sure.
I believe it is on my notebook in my classroom. Hold on.
Okay. Will I remember to edit this? I'm not sure. We'll see. Will Nicole ever come back? That is the question.
That's a testimony right there.
That you came back?
No, that I found a letter that wasn't planned. You know what I'm saying? That I wasn't prepared with, that I was able to track that down, retrace my steps.
That's awesome. And for the podcast listeners, who didn't hear, it was about a minute and a half that it took you to find that. You had to go to another room. And that was a, well, it may not be heard, but I was talking to the recording and the video at YouTube and you know, just trying to build the suspense, wondering if you would come back, wondering if you would get, you know, you know, find your rabbit hole. And you did. And that should feel good.
It feels great. It's one of the many, many times. I think in 10 weeks, you have a lot of opportunities, even just as an aside, you know, being able to feel the success of being on time for the podcasts 3 times a week. And when things came up
for the group,
it's been an awesome experience. Okay. So the letter, we wrote, by the way, on the fly. Okay.
Right. And that's one of the things and this is sort of newer to this season of the coaching groups, and something that I'm going to continue to do going forward, because we know that starting is the hardest part. And so like we do a lot of these exercises where we'll spend 7, 10, spends up to 15 minutes getting started in the group, working on it together, then sort of sharing the experience of what it was like to work on it. And I think the conversations around that since doing that have been just way more powerful. So, all right, Nicole, share your dear ADHD.
So this was part of my understanding of that I had figured out that, you know, ADD isn't this magical attribute that had been that it was giving itself power. Dear ADD, this is the letter where I tell you that I have finally figured out who you are. The talented Mr. Ripley, you've been masquerading as something different than who you really are, pretending to be an asset, a learning style, which has caused me to question myself, my intellect, and has depleted my self-esteem to the point of causing me complete inertia. Well, no more. Today is the day those little Italian police came driving on their little moped, knocking on your door saying, "We know who you are. I can finally separate you from myself. I am not ADD. I am creative. I am intelligent. I am kind. I am loving. I'm a good parent. I am a thoughtful wife who is supportive. I'm a person who needs skills, practice, repetition, and habits. Those three areas are my opportunities for growth." And then that's where I stopped writing because you called time. So
that's awesome.
But you get the gist.
So why did you join the group in the first place?
Because I didn't know what else to do. I was indirectly causing, I wasn't being the kind of mother and wife and businesswoman that I envisioned that I would be, or that I thought that maybe I was capable of. And I just knew that I knew there was nothing wrong with just reaching out and asking for help at that point, because I didn't really have anything left to lose. And I knew that you, because you have ADD, you would never judge me or treat me the way that coach and that did so long ago. And you're successful. And I aspired toward, and I'm not trying to put you on a pedestal and say, "Oh, you're this perfect person who solved everything."
Cause we all know that is not the case.
But to be able to thrive in the environment in which, you know, you're in, it's like you're obviously doing something right. And it wasn't just a one good show. It's like I'd heard this over a number of times. So I wanted what you have. And it's been a great journey so far.
So I would love to maybe hear about some of the your sort of takeaways, the things that you really feel you've learned from the group, some of maybe the insights. What I'd like to do first, though, is I want to take a quick break. But when we come back, I really want to hear from everything from mindset to how you're planning and anything that some surprising discoveries that you feel you've made during the course of this group. So we will be right back.
My name is Stephen Tonti. I have ADHD. I am a writer, director, and public speaker. And I was a part of Eric Tiver's ADHD Rewired coaching and accountability group. And a message for those considering joining: I have not been a part of a support group or support network anything like Eric's ADHD coaching group in my 25 years on the planet. And after being a part of that coaching group, it is a mission of mine to not only facilitate groups like it, but also be a part of a group whenever I can, for as long as I can. One of the strongest impressions that I got from the group was my first impression. I'd say top fiver. I, again, was sort of reluctant in the beginning to join the group at all, because of this preconceived notion that I was working it out and had done a pretty good job of figuring it out myself. So when the first session rolled around, it was a Monday, I you know, did this kind of arguably arrogant thing where I was gonna take the session on the road. Like, I had taken a train to Brooklyn and had scheduled a meeting right at the end of the session. So I was like, I've got an hour for the session. I'm going to be at this dude's house in Brooklyn when the session ends. And I'm on my phone walking through Brooklyn on Zoom. And within the first 15 minutes of the first session, just the introductions, we spent the first 30 minutes introducing the 11 or 12 of us. And by the fourth person, I was pretty damn near tears, which I did not expect at all. You can't really plan for that sort of thing. And the reason was, it was extremely clear. There's no confusion as to why I was feeling that way. It dawned on me like a tidal wave. It crashed like a tidal wave that I was in this very special group of people from all walks of life, varying ages, all sharing one very key specific quality, right? Which is ADHD. And we all come at it from different angles and different places, but sharing that with 12 people is it's very intangible, right? And hard to quantify, but extremely important. And it crashed on me. Like, in, you know, it just hit me like a freight train all of a sudden. And I was like, I think the thought was, oh my God, I get this. I get it. This is gonna be really important. I didn't realize it's gonna be important, but I can tell now this is gonna be important. And in closing, get ready for the first session, because four to five introductions in, you'll get it. It'll wash over you like a tidal wave.
I want to thank Stephen Tonti for sitting down with me at the CHAD conference to share his experience of joining this group. So you've watched this entire video. You possibly have heard people from past coaching groups on my podcast to talk about the experience that they've had in the coaching group. Go to coachingrewired.com and schedule that call today. Give yourself the gift of coaching, of community, of connection. Click that link and schedule the call with me. It's no obligation. This is more than just a coaching group. This is ADHD Rewired. All right, we are back with Nicole, and she just shared with us her dear ADHD. So just in case you had, your mind wandered, right before the break and that you didn't catch that, you might want to rewind it, because I think it was really powerful. But what we're going to do now is Nicole's going to share with us sort of some of her transformation that she experienced, some of the specific skills, some of the highlights, some of the unexpected things that she got out of being in the group, and we'll hit some of those things. We might go on a tangent. It's very possible, but we'll try to stay focused. All right, Nicole, where do you want to start in this realm?
So some fun things that I have and useful things I've been given in this class have been, I think, predominantly the vocabulary to describe to my family how my brain works. We've been able to actually attach words to things such as time blind. We just have to say that and everybody kind of knows what that means. Perfectionism has become a word in our house. We call it a buzzword. So if someone uses the word perfect, we're actually allowed to do like this buzzer sound, like, you know? And I think
awesome.
I was telling
you. I love that. I love that.
That I was painting my daughter's fingernails. She wanted a particular fun little thing that we'd saw on Pinterest, which is like the, yeah. So I was going for like the look. I was going to make it look exactly how they looked on Pinterest. And like, she's like, Mom, you can stop. They look great. And I said, well, I'm just going to do this a little bit more. And she looked at me and said, now that's perfectionism. And she said, you know, they're fine how they are. And if you keep going with this, I mean, I'm going to like email Eric Tiver's show and say, you know, you're being perfectionistic, and I'm going to do like the sound on your, to your classmates, you know, cause she's super cute. So
I love when our kids call us out on our stuff. My son, a couple of weeks ago, building Legos with him, and I was like getting really hyper focused in like building this thing, and he goes, all right, Dad, the first thing to do is stand up. And I was like, which is awesome. I love it.
We're right in the middle of reading the Mysterious Benedictine Society, I think, or something is the name of the book. Anyway, it's in, there's this whole thing in there about how nobody listens to kids, nobody believes kids, but in fact they possess enormous wisdom. So yeah, it's a fun book. Okay. The second thing you just mentioned one right there, which is hyper-focus. I had thought hyper-focus was one of my greatest strengths. Again, like when I, yeah.
Talk about that though, because especially for new listeners who haven't heard me sort of talk about hyper-focus, because I don't believe that it's an asset in most situations. It can be leveraged as a strength, but it has some real side effects that I think for most situations are not worth the strength. So talk about it from your perspective.
So at first so you introduced us to a technique that would allow us to break out of a hyper-focused state. And I thought, well, what the heck's the point of that? I want to stay in that state. That's when I'm on a roll. That's when I'm getting stuff done. That's one of the benefits of my ADD. When I am in that state, I can convince myself that whatever I'm working on, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 40 minutes, 2 hours, it could be 2 a.m, my values and my priorities somehow get shifted during that time. And I am being totally productive toward something that in reality is not at all my goal. And then I've lost sleep, I've lost time, and again, my self-esteem decreases because I am not achieving what it is I set out to do. One of the cool things you said in the beginning of the class, you defined productivity. You said, you know, it's producing something. It's a product. So you can be busy and you can do all this busy work, but like the goal here, guys, is that we're going to get something done. And I went on and I thought, how often do I finish these hyper-focused sessions without a product worth, perhaps it's time, value,
yeah,
and money. Mm-hmm. That's the biggest reason why hyper-focus, and you know, yeah.
And the other piece, the draining of our executive functioning, sort of resource, because it is a limited resource. You know, this idea that willpower is, it's not on will call, right? It's like we can't just say, all right, it's time to focus. It's like, well, if you were up all night, like, because you were like in a 6 hour, 8 hour hyper focus, like, it doesn't matter how much important stuff you have the next day, your brain's going to feel like mush.
And it's been valuable for me as an aspiring artist to learn that I have to schedule my time for my creative hyper-focus sessions. So like there, I think some people might listen to this and argue, but that's how I get my cup full. It is if it's planned for. It is if you have a timer or a start or a stop in place. And then that you honor the stop time, because I've had lots of timers go off and I'm like, you know, snooze, dip the old brush back in the paint, keep going. Right. And I've now trained myself to associate by doing that. That's a form of disrespect to myself, my family, and my priorities and my time. And I also have learned to trust myself more now, where if I want to give myself a reward, great example, I kept a couple of really emotionally challenging appointments for one of my children that we had to go on. I didn't want to go. I did not want to do it, et cetera. It's something in the past I would have seriously considered just rescheduling, right? So I stopped and I was like, what's it going to take for me to go on this? That was the day we talked about the numbing out thing.
Yeah.
And so that's a whole other thing. So I'm like, I'm going to go on this appointment and I'm going to reward myself with something healthy. I'm going to set the timer and I get to paint for 60 minutes. And I never told the class this. I actually made myself a sign that says, I love you, but please don't talk to me. And I laminated it and I hung it around my neck.
So
like my
that.
Family knows, like, don't talk to me. This is my time. I earned it. I got my work done. I got my stuff done. Mom is painting.
That is awesome. I love that. I love you, but please don't talk to me. That's in a sign. That's great.
Because I only bring that up because I'm not saying we don't have the right to go to that sort of la la land, whatever that is for any one of us, sports, you know, whatever, wherever we want to go to, like, really, you know, but there has to be a boundary for me. Everybody.
Well, I think it's for all of us. I mean, we need to prioritize self-care, and part of self-care is doing those things that really fill you up. You know, one of the things that I have committed to doing since we've started this current session with doing three groups, that I knew that for me, I needed to disengage from work between the second and third group. Otherwise, I was going to need to give the third group a discount because I know myself and I know, like, I'm super on those, like, first two groups. And I want to be able to bring that same level of energy to my third group in the afternoon. And so I made a commitment at the very start of these groups that I'm going to walk away from the computer. I'm going to spend time meditating, playing guitar, and or watching TED Talks. And one of the things that I've done is I've actually substituted, I've stopped watching TED Talks in the last, like, week or two because I wanted more time to play guitar. And you're saying, as you were saying, it's scheduled time for creativity. You know, one of my themes for the year, we talk about, you know, as we're doing kind of goal planning, adding this element of having themes. You know, last year my theme was play, and I didn't really do much with that. And when I was reflecting on my last year, when I started planning for this year, I was like, all right, so what were the things that would fall under play that I did that really brought me joy? And there was one thing that I was able to identify with, and that was going to see fish at Wrigley Field. And like that, I loved that. And it was like, all right, I needed my focus, instead of just having it be play, it needs to be music, because that's more of a focused thing for me. And so I'm right now, like 3 to 4 days a week, I spend a minimum of a half an hour, not just like fiddling around on the guitar, but really like reteaching myself the guitar. And it's awesome. I love it. It feels so good. It feels productive because I'm actually like learning things. I've been playing guitar since college, but I've like known the same, I don't know, 10 chords and haven't really grown from that. And so I'm really wanting to grow in that area, because that is an area of my life that I have, that has been, you know, I used to call myself, and I've been calling myself, I was a musician in my former life. You know, I used to play piano and keyboards. I still do, but I used to do it where I would actually get paid for it and play gigs and stuff. And I miss that so much. And so it's, you know, when you have these things that sort of you keep coming back to, it's almost like whack-a-mole. You know, it's like you push it away because life gets busy, but it keeps coming back and it keeps coming back. You got to pay attention to those things.
Totally agree. I like the whack-a-mole analogy, because we have so many things competing for our attention. And so very often, like every time I get the Rosetta Stone advertisement, I'm like, I used to be fluent in French. How did I let that slip by? I should be, you know, I should really $200. You know, and before I know it, I feel bad that I'm not practicing my French. But that doesn't come, that's not really from that place. The whack-a-mole is the thing that keeps coming back up. Like, I see a paintbrush and I want to just run over there and just, I want to paint a canvas. Like that fire, that passion, that's how I know that that's, you know. It was funny because when you were talking, you know, I was thinking about how Nisha, if Nisha were like here with us right now, she would say, that's really brave, Eric. Wouldn't she? She would totally say you're brave for following through that music theme and then, and doing, and I'll never forget just how great I felt when I like took a picture of this painting I had done and sent it. And she's like, painting is really brave. And I thought, oh, I love you for that. 'Cause it made me feel great, you know?
That's awesome. And she there's a line that she often, I think it's, I forget who she's quote. She's like the quote, like master. She can like quote like anything. It's really incredible. This idea that that benign create or untapped creativity is not benign.
Ooh, we just don't know who said it. Can I take one quick second?
Yeah.
In your checklist, we never said, does your thing have power? I need to grab my power source. I have it right by me. Hold on.
I'm adding that to my checklist right now. So before the episodes, we always go through a checklist. And I'm surprised this has never come up. So while she's going to get her power cord, I am adding to my workflow, which I actually showed on the podcast, the episode with Nikki and Pete Kinzer. Not Nikki Wright and Nikki Kinzer and Pete Wright.
So mindful meditation, that's was a surprising benefit. I won't get into it too much because it's different for everyone. And plus it's just, it was just something that I didn't expect that would help me to open the door. It was a surprise solution to opening a door to problems I didn't. It's kind of like 2 + 2 = 4 when it comes to learning how to sit in your space and to be. It was through that that I have learned to stop judging myself, to be in the moment. You hear people, all these parenting books are like, just be in the moment with your kids. Just be there. And you're like,
how do you do that?
Okay. Yeah. Right. You know, and I don't, it's cool to me when I trust someone enough, like I trust you to just practice a skill. Just try this.
Yeah.
I do it. And then I get something I didn't expect out of it. It's a benefit. That's cool because I don't let a lot of people in to my inner circle.
So let me ask you, except for the you know, 5,000 to 8,000 people who are going to be listening to this episode. I hope that doesn't make you nervous.
Yeah, I'm trying not to really think about that.
So you had to say that. So every Monday in the group, we begin with, I would say a 7 to 12 minute guided sort of mindfulness based meditation. Has there been a specific sort of a piece to one of those that really stood out for you?
Not particularly. Okay. I think just more or less the practice of it, perhaps the lack of, there is no sort of like, you know, there's no crescendo. It's just like, this is what we do. It's just, we're here. We bring who we are and what we are to that moment. And it's this anti-perfectionistic practice of just, I show up. I show up as I am, not as I would prefer to be, not, oh, well, if only I had worn this or done this or been more prepared. I just show up. And I have found that I do really well in life when I just show up.
Can I share, the text message that you sent me yesterday?
Yes.
So at some point yesterday, it was at 7:50 p.m. last night. Here's what Nicole wrote me. Eric, I'm going to have to reschedule our taping tomorrow. I'm having the most difficult 2 weeks and this whole class, and it's getting progressively that I've had in this whole class, and it's getting progressively worse by the hour. I am not going to be able to bring the vibe to the taping that would represent my experience overall. I need some time to get things in order, get ready for my 2 trips that I'm taking in a matter of days, and I need to make amends to blah, 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 intentional censoring. Please excuse the late notice. I would do it if, but it's just not the right time and I don't want to waste your time. An hour and a half later, she writes, Eric, ignore my last message if you got it. I'm not going to let the past 72 hours determine my attitude about my progress. Game on for tomorrow.
Bingo.
And I'm glad that I didn't see the first message and I saw all that together. I was like, awesome. That was like, you clearly were like pushing through that perfectionism, like in the moment. Mm-hmm. And you showed up.
Because I have a great deal of respect for who you are, for what you do, and for the audience that's receiving this message. Okay. We deserve to listen to people who are bringing their A game. And I had anticipated and wanted to share certain things that I was in such a funk yesterday. Between the two of us, my husband and I, we sent our daughter to school with only part of her uniform on. And she was fully clothed, but she didn't have a part of the uniform that's required by her school. Okay. So her teacher traipsed her through the classroom, down through the school, and made her put on a uniform that was in the like lost and found or dirty uniform basket in like the nurse's office, and then traipsed her back up. And then my other daughter, in true sibling form, said, well, I'm sure someone probably peed on that. And then you had to wear it around the school. I was like, I'm sure it was clean. Okay. It was a clean garment. There, you know, like that was what we needed. Right. So then my daughter's crying and it's just like, and I just thought, my God, get it together. Like you send your kid without part of her uniform. How can I go and talk about, you know, any progress I've made? And then it was just like, bam, I stopped myself and I'm like, you know, that's perfectionism. And I started just listing and I just started looking around my house at things that I've accomplished that would not have been possible if I hadn't done this class and met the people who are in my group. I learned from them. They're such an inspiration to me. And I look at just even the jobs and the careers that these people have, and they're doing way more than eking by in life. Okay. They're successful professional, and we all have bad days. Plus there's linear thinking moms out there sending their kids to school without all their uniform on, right? They're doing it. It's just, but I choose to make that mean something. Yeah. And I just sent you that text like, nope. Not doing it.
That's awesome. And thank you for sharing that. And, yeah. You know, and I think it's true for myself, and I've been through these things, like, you know, so many times I've learned that even like when I'm having that bad day or bad week, like our brain tricks us into thinking that this is how I always am.
Yes.
Right. And so knowing that, you could hold these two thoughts sort of together. So you have this this thought of, oh, I'm screwing up everything right now, and this is how I always screw up things. And then also understand, okay, when I'm in that sort of darker place, like that's how my brain thinks, and I know that's not the case. So it's even though it's this whole idea that feelings are not facts, right?
And remember in the beginning, okay, very first thing, you know, we do, I won't give away your class, but one of the very first things we do is we identify some of those moments and successes and strengths. And you specifically say in the beginning, you're going to want to hang on to this because there might come a time in the class when you are not feeling, because if you're going to really invest yourself and you're going to grow and you're going to change, there are going to be days where you're going to leave it all on the court. You're going to, at least for me, I chose to be in this class 110%, partially because it's how I am, but partially because I feel like if I'm going to invest, if I want to experience maximum change, I need to put maximum effort in. So.
Did you say that you had you sort of listed some of the successes and the things you've accomplished in the group?
Some of the success. Well, I was saying that I had looked at some of them yesterday. I had listed some of the things like, I finally, oh yes. So some of the things that we also got from the group, like some of the tangible skills were, you know, the technical skills that were required or are required for us to sort of function as a group, whether it's Zoom, Facebook, Messenger, chatting, private chats, et cetera. And Nish has been really great about providing instruction if we need to do that. And I was not hip to nor interested in social media prior to this class. I am a very private person and I am very cautious and selective about what I put out into the world. And so
you do know this is going to be heard by a lot of people, right?
You know, I think at the end of the day, I'm kind of like, there have to be more people like me who are being judged by other people, whether it's a teacher or whether it's an in-law or whether it's whoever. And we need some advocates who, we need people who are like on our side to say, those people don't define who you are and your ADD doesn't define who you are. You are who you are. Maybe you're smart. Maybe you suck. Maybe you're lazy. I mean, you could be any of those bad things. You could be any of those good things, but that's not your ADD. And it's up to you to change that if you want to, or love and accept right where you are, who you are. Right?
Would you be able to, could you imagine yourself, you know, 9 weeks ago from today and being able to sort of look at yourself where you are today? Would you believe it?
No. I didn't, first of all, I was so distraught and so hopeless that I would have said, I was just is apathetic the word I'm looking for? Just whatever. I just didn't care. I really didn't think there was a lot. I don't know. I just felt like I had to do something.
I'm glad that this is what you chose to do.
Thanks. I am too.
So Nicole, what would you, for listeners, what would you tell them if they're thinking about joining our next session or maybe a future session if they're listening to this, after it came out?
Eric, I wanted to touch on one last point you asked me earlier, because I think that
I invented one more thing.
Pardon me?
So I invented one more thing, Itis. So absolutely, you can have one more thing too.
just because this was something that I felt like, oh my gosh, almost just on a day, I was starting to think that I was losing my mind with trying to figure out what type of planner / communication tool I wanted to use to manage the flow of communication that is in all of our lives, right? And I had a huge breakthrough around figuring out what works for me. And I can guarantee you that I would not have accomplished that if I weren't in this class, because it was a safe place to try out that daily plan. It wasn't in, you know, a high stakes corporate environment where you're not hopefully trying out new things and at the cost of your company or your role or whatever, right? This was like, if I made a plan to do something with my accountability group and my intention was to follow through, but then I didn't have the skills or the tools to do that as I had intended, we were able to sort of dissect, okay, why didn't you follow through on that? But not in a judgmental way, in a truly scientific, like, let's look
at
this.
It's the curious why.
Yes, exactly. And then say, okay, well, let's try something else tomorrow. Let's see, where else are you going to get that? Even the people who love you the most, they have too much at stake and too much invested. My husband does not want to sit down and have another conversation about whether or not I should use my Franklin planner or my iMac. You know, I mean, really, he's just like, seriously, Nicole, like, we're not having this discussion. And so, yeah.
So how do you plan now?
Paper, straight up paper.
Isn't it amazing? It's like you strip down everything and it's like the simplest.
And Evernote.
Okay.
Paper and Evernote. So Evernote is my on-demand. I need to be able to type a word. I need to be able to have, you know, like I can go there right now and say, and type the word softball and all those registration forms, everything that I need to have, you know, when I need it, it's right there. And at the same token, I've learned that if I enter something electronically into my schedule, I have total amnesia. You could be like, what do you have going on next week? I wouldn't have a clue.
Oh, me neither.
I would be like, I know stuff's in there,
yeah,
but I don't know what. Whereas if I write it down and if I sort of process it, I have almost a scary good memory, almost photographic, honestly.
Yeah.
It's just different.
No, that's great. And that's, you know, in part, so much of this is discovering your, like, what works for you. Because what works for me might not work for you. You may find that there are pieces that you like that you get to borrow, and then you sort of, you know, make it your own. And that's what I want for everybody.
That, don't you hate that? When someone says it's something different, because then I'll never forget my husband once being like, we need a book. We need a book on such and such. And we're going to Google that. We're going to get that book. And I was like, that's what we really want though, isn't it? Like a solution to this that's in one CD or whatever. Well, that's probably not going to happen. So therefore, because I don't have time to read 7,000 books on ADD, I could just take your class. And yes, I'm still going to have a toolkit laid before me. I'm going to have to customize it. At least I know that what's in that kit has worked for a fair number of people and that it could work for me.
You know, just give me a thought about, we should write a book. Maybe the title is Your Ideal Planning System. It will be like a 10 page like of introduction, and then the rest of the pages are going to be blank. And it's for you to figure out. It's for you to experiment with. You know, and I think that's just an important piece of this process. Because let's say you get this system that is really, really working for you. There's a shelf life to that system, because you're either going to get bored of it, the context is going to change where it's no longer meeting your needs. We're constantly having to sort of re-update and reinvent the way we get things done and manage all the details of life. And, I think, you know, something that you're not going to see in a planner, it's what goes into it emotionally, right? Mm-hmm. And it's the mindset piece. I hope that for listeners, they really heard your sort of journey from coming into this group, really being able to practice and explore and be vulnerable and really have that growth both in productivity of actually getting actual things done, but also these shifts in mindset that really make a difference and do fuel the growth that you have. So your rocket actually ends up in the launching pad and not the runaway.
You know,
you see what I did there? You like that?
I totally I skipped right over that because it was like, I was just choosing not to really even like focus. Yeah. That's my ability to not focus on that. You were talking about this essentially. I was thinking about how we would market your blank planner. And it reminded me of a comedian who does a thing on, you know, who must just lay in bed at night and just laugh. The guy who invented the card that's blank inside. He goes to his buddies and he's like, man, I am making $1 million. And guess what I'm selling? A piece of paper with a fold in it. It's blank inside. People are buying it, you know? Like a blank card. Because really, like, you find them everywhere. Hallmarks now are like, just, it's blank inside. And I was thinking about your planner and kind of saying that, like, we should just sell a planner that's like blank inside.
There's, you know, I think with those of us with ADHD, there are lots of ideas. I'm not giving any qualitative description to these ideas. We just have lots of ideas. So, Nicole, what idea do you want to leave listeners with?
If I could leave listeners with one idea, it would be for those of you who are newly diagnosed with ADD, especially if you So if you don't yet have children, but you plan to, or if you have children that are small, take the time and invest it in yourself now, because you have no idea what, how much you are going to love those little people. There's no way you could ever know that. And when they hurt, you hurt. And when you are responsible in your own mind for causing them pain, forgetfulness, whatever it might be, that's a really awful place to be. And it's really hard when you're in the thick of it, of parenting children who are at an age where they need a parent who's got it all figured out and all dialed in, and you're still trying to figure out some stuff. If I could help somebody who isn't yet there to take that time and invest that in themselves now, it's almost like I'm helping those little future kids to not have to go through that. And I would do anything to help with that. That's why I came on your show today.
Nicole, thank you so much for being a guest and for really showing up in so many ways. I mean, it's from today's conversations in the group to conversations that you and I have had recently. I just want to thank you, and I want to congratulate you on really how much progress you've made. It's been pretty awesome sort of watching the journey. So thank you so much. Well, do you want to leave sort of contact info, or would you rather that people leave you alone?
No, I actually have an email address that's kind of generic, if you will. And I'm just going to write it out so I don't say it wrong. So it's Plymouth, PLYMOUTHMN, like Minnesota, 7 at gmail.com. So Plymouth, MN7 at gmail.com.
Nicole, thank you so, so much. And we'll talk again. Well, me and you will talk tomorrow.
Couple more weeks to go. Yeah. Class, so who knows?
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
ADHD Rewired is more than just a podcast. We are a community focused on learning, growing, and connection. The website is ADHDRewired.com. You can find additional summaries and resources for each episode. Learn more about the ADHD Rewired Coaching and Accountability Group, and sign up for my email newsletter to get exclusive content you won't get anywhere else. It's all at ADHDRewired.com. You can follow me on Twitter at Eric Tivers. You want to see interviews with content not heard on the podcast? Subscribe to ADHD Rewired on YouTube. Don't just be a passive listener, be an active member of the community. Submit your request to join our free and growing community on Facebook. Watch your message inbox. You will get a message either from myself or Nisha Subramanian. Podcasts change lives. You can make a difference in someone's life by spreading the word about this podcast. Mention it in your online communities on Facebook, Twitter, Reddit, or wherever you hang out online. And be sure to share it with your friends, family, and clients. If you're a member of CHAD or any other ADHD support group, tell them about this show. You can even show them how to download it on their phone. And if you really love this particular episode, please hit share on your podcast player. I'm only one person, and I count on you to help me spread the word and get this message out there. One of the biggest things that you really can do to support this podcast and help other people discover it is to leave an honest rating and a review on iTunes or Stitcher. Looking for more ways to listen and learn? Get a free audiobook and a 30-day free trial at Audible by going to audibletrial.com/ADHD Rewired. Not sure where to start? You could start with Brené Brown's The Gifts of Imperfections or her 6-hour recorded workshop, The Power of Vulnerability. If you've already listened to those, then you might want to move on to Daring Greatly or her most recent book, Rising Strong. This is Eric Tivers, and I want to leave you with a question. Do you stay up late to finish work, so you only sleep for 5 hours, and then the next day you have trouble focusing, So you stay up late to finish work? If so, you might be in the ADHD productivity sleep cycle. Try this instead. Go to sleep. Get an accountability partner to check in with or about your sleep time. Get more sleep, get more done. Thanks for listening. Until next time. You're still here. Why?